Welcome back to the Monmouth Basketball Hawks Nest Podcast. We're sorry it's been long, long overdue. We've had a lot going on our end. I am flying solo tonight. The guys are busy with Mark coaching basketball, high school basketball, and Mike's doing his own work. So I'm by myself tonight. I'll try to get somebody on for the next one, player, coach, maybe Jaden or somebody from the CAA. But either way, we're back tonight for a quicker episode because Mark's not going to be going at me with stats and X's and O's. So just me tonight, give a quick little update for what's been going on around Monmouth. I would want to do this a lot sooner. My wife is due with our first child in about 10 days. So it's been a lot of nesting and organizing the house and building things and putting car seats in and all stuff that I've never done before. So it's been a lot, and we're very happy and excited, but it's taking me away from the podcast a little bit. So sorry, guys, that comes first, obviously, but I want to make sure I talk to you guys tonight and check in with this Monmouth team. So the last time we talked to you guys, we were previewing the Princeton Rider games, actually, with Kyle Franco. It's been that long. Before that, Monmouth's coming off a big win versus West Virginia. So since then, things have been pretty much right where we expected. I actually nailed my out-of-conference record with 7-6. It's exactly how they turned out. I think it was a very productive out-of-conference season. I don't think any Monmouth fan should be upset with 7-6. So if we really go back and check in from the last time we talked, Princeton is really the only outlier. So Monmouth lost a really rough one to Princeton. They did not play well in the game. They were at home. They were expecting to play better, honestly. They were coming off a great win, a really good week at Monmouth. And, you know, they laid an egg in that game. And they were upset about it. King talked about it. We were really down after that game. The home fans were great. They had a lot of people out that day on a Saturday, I think. And it was disappointing. But you know what? Princeton is also an NCAA team. Like, they are going to be in the tournament. They are a top 30, 35-ish team right now. They're getting votes in the top 25 poll. So they're a real team. And, you know, we played teams that were better than them better. So that's what made it disappointing. And, the student-athletes know it. The basketball players and the coaches know it. It is what it is. They lost a tough one, and I think it was 82-58, something along those lines. But it is what it is, guys. They're a really, really good team. Give Princeton a lot of credit. And the team bounced back pretty quickly because after that, they had a three-game winning streak. They beat an okay Lehigh team at home, and they went to the Palestra for three games in a row for that tournament around Thanksgiving. And they started hot. They beat a really good Belmont team. That was kind of the one you really wanted to get. They beat a not-so-great Lafayette team. We took care of them. And they kind of ran out of gas on Sunday versus Penn. I mean, Penn's a really good team as well. They're a very strong Ivy League team. They're going to have something to say about the Ivy League title against Princeton. So they ran out of gas. They played two games in a row. They won on the third day. They didn't have enough left in them. And things didn't go right that day. We didn't shoot the ball well. And that happens sometimes. But overall, we said going into the weekend, if we can go 2-1, it'll be a win. 3-0 is a bonus. We went 2-1, so you can't really be upset about that. And they lost to a good team. Following that one, tough loss to a really good Cornell team. Again, the Ivy League is strong this year, guys. Some years, we'll play these Ivy teams, and you don't always know what you're getting. Some years, Yale and those guys are a little bit stronger. Some years, Cornell is not great, and we've played Brown in the past and some of these other teams, and you don't really know what you're getting. Usually it's one or two teams at the top of the Ivy. This year they're three or four or five deep where they're really, really tough teams. And they played great against Cornell. They just couldn't come out with a win. They bounced back with the game of the year probably so far. Northern Illinois, team from a higher conference than us, but probably a small half a step higher than the CAA is maybe. They've had a couple of years where they've had two teams in the tournament. Northern Illinois has been known to be a good program over the years, and Jakari Spence was the hero in that one. I couldn't make the game that day. I was actually throwing my wife's 30th surprise party later that night, so there's no way I was getting there. But Jakari Spence, days after His grandmother passes away, and you know he's with his family for services, and you know he's definitely having a tough time. He said in the media that, and King said it, that his grandma was extremely close to him and helped raise him, and you know that's a really, really hard thing to go through. And to see that kid run down the court and run into the 3-point line and bank in that shot, it was unbelievable to watch on TV. I'm sure everybody in the stadium was just out of their mind, and you just felt so good for the kid, because to be a walk-on in Division I sports and not have a scholarship and not have any guarantees you're going to be there next year, and for him to be starting for us and hit a shot like that, it was such a cool moment for him and for the program. And you know, you credit him for coming back, because he probably had other teams that were interested after the year he had last year, and he chose to come back, and King rewarded him with a starting spot, and he looks like a different player this year. I mean, last year you knew Jakari was a walk-on. You knew he did the best job he could, and he played pretty well. He took the point guard spot over, and he did what he could. I said it though, the first home game, he looked like a different kid. Physically, he looked different. His confidence, he looked different. Everything about him just looked like, you know, this kid's not a walk-on. This kid's a D1 player. And a solid mid-major point guard. We weren't thinking, oh, he's doing his best, he's a walk-on. We weren't thinking that anymore. This kid is a legit D1 player, and he's proven it to everybody. A really cool moment for him beating Northern Illinois at the buzzer. He said he knows his grandma kind of guided in that shot, and you know, there's nothing better than that for your program and for your team that you root for. And to hear something like that, you know, hats off to Jakari Spence. Awesome moment for the kid and for the team. After that, I went to the Seton Hall game. My buddy went there, and we took the drive up to Newark at Prudential. Tight game last year, first game of the season. We were not the team that we are now. We were a shell of what we are this year, and you know, obviously we struggled last year. They beat the brakes off of us at the end, and it was what it was. We weren't a good team. This year is a different story. We were in that game until the final minute, guys. Down 3, probably with a minute to a minute and a half left. They had some garbage time, breakaway dunks and layups and foul shots, and it made it a 9-point win for Seton Hall. That Seton Hall team beat UConn, who's number one. Okay? That Seton Hall team has beaten 3 or 4 ranked teams already, and they're on the cusp of making it into the top 25. I believe they were the first team out receiving votes today. So they're going to be in the top 25 before the season's over, probably. And we took them down to the wire. So it's something to be said that we can compete with these better teams. King said it in the offseason in his podcast with us. We built this team knowing everybody was laughing at us last year, and we were not going to be laughed at again. And so far, Princeton's the only game people might have been laughing at him or a little frustrated. That's it. Seton Hall, they took down to the wire, and they ran away at the very end. So, something to feel good about. You don't want to get too high into moral victories, but for a team that knocked off the number one team in the country and we took them down to the last minute, I'd say it's as much of a moral victory as you can have. They had two kind of tight wins over Rider and Manhattan. Shouldn't have been that close, but honestly, Rider's always going to be a close game, no matter how good or bad we are or they are. It's a rivalry. It's always going to be there as long as we play each other. I'm not so sure we're going back to Rider, but you know, as long as they come to us, and if you know King decides to go back there in the future and changes his mind, maybe it's always going to be a tight game. It doesn't matter what conference we're in or how good we are or how you know somebody's rebuilding. It doesn't matter. It's always going to be close. Manhattan, not a great team this year. We snuck out with a win. A win's a win. Oklahoma played them New Year's Eve, number 12 in the country. 25, 30 minutes, we were there. We were there with the 12th best team in the country. And I know we lost by, I think it was 13 or 14 in the end. It was by no means a blowout. But we were there. Okay, so a lot of teams get run out of the gym from our conference or from the MAC and CAA and teams like that. They get run out and lose by 25, 30. We were there down 7 or 8 until the final 10 minutes, and they ran away a little bit. So overall, the out of conference, I couldn't have been happier. I mean, the only game you can really look back on and say, they laid an egg that day. Laid an egg that day. That was Princeton. That's it. one game out of 13. All right, that's what you want. And they showed up in the games where some years they don't show up. That pre-Christmas game always scares me. I hate that game. I hate the game. The kids want to go home. They want to see their families. The students are off campus. They're in the dorms all by themselves or in the houses. There's no one on campus. There's no one at the game. It's a dangerous place to be. And most years we lose that game. I remember being a student and we played St. Francis Brooklyn and they were terrible. We lost by 25 at home. So that game's always been a nail, I guess a thorn in our side over the years. And this year it wasn't. They took down Northern Illinois. They beat Rider, they beat Manhattan. They won all those games right before Christmas that we're used to them losing. So, you know, credit to this team staying tough and mentally tough and getting the job done when they had to. But 7-6, that is nothing to cry about. It's a really solid record. We didn't get 7 wins all of last year. Okay, think about that for a minute. By the time CAA got here, we matched our win total from last year. So King did a really good job in the offseason of putting this team together with great young players, with transfers, and you know they're putting themselves in a position to be a top half CAA team, and we're going to talk about that now. So getting in the CAA real quick, we've had a 3-3 record so far through 6 games. Towson was a big win at home. It was kind of a rock fight. I want to check the score on that one. It was like 52-46. I had a dinner for my real estate team that night. I was not able to attend and get out of that. So I wasn't at the game. I was following it, and I thought it was ESPN got it wrong when the score was like 22-20 at halftime. I thought they had it wrong. They didn't. The final score was in the 40s and 50s. I'm getting this pulled up now. The score was 51-43. I mean, that's a rock fight in college basketball. But Towson's a good team. All right, they're a top 5 CAA team. And they're somebody that we're trying to knock off and, you know, take them off the hill. And I think that's a team that we can possibly beat again. And maybe we move ahead of them in the standings this year. We're not, you know, middle of the pack like we thought we might be in 7th, 8th, 9th place. Maybe we beat Towson and we jump them this year. After that, we beat up Northeastern pretty good. We were up 25-30. I was at that game. Didn't have a chance in that game. They made a little bit of a run for a while. We fell asleep, but we got it right back up. We won by 19. No big deal. Then you have the road trip. Mark and Mike and I are in a chat together, and I said in there, you got to try to win one. If you can win one out of these three, you put yourself in a pretty good spot because you get Hampton at home after that, you'll be 4-2. You get 2 wins, it's a bonus, 3, you know, we're all going crazy. They lost all 3, okay? Now, it's not all bad news. Obviously, you want to win at least one of those. UNC Wilmington was tough. They were 0-2. They were not happy with themselves about how the season started. You knew they were going to get better. You knew they were going to start winning games. That home crowd is one of the best in all of mid-major basketball for a big game. If you didn't see them versus Charleston the other night, go look up some YouTube clips or on Twitter or TikTok or anywhere. They were rocking in that place. Organized chants. Students were dancing around and swaying back and forth and doing their, I mean, they were awesome, awesome student section. I'm hoping one day we'll have something like that at Monmouth, and I know King feels the same way. You hope that can happen one day for us, but that's a tough place to play, and we were there for a while. They pulled away at the end, and they were more physical. That's really what it came down to. They were more physical, they executed, and they bullied us a little bit towards the end of the game. We were not outmatched by any means, but they're half a step ahead of us, I would say. They're a little ahead of us. We still have a young roster. We're still building, and we'll get them one day. But Wilmington's a really good team, and they're showing that now. They're on a streak now. They're showing it. Next game at Charleston, they beat us up. It's kind of like something we've talked about where you can't really look at the scoreboard at the end and see that was accurate. Like, we didn't lose to Seton Hall as bad as it showed, and we didn't beat Hampton as good as it showed by 8. We barely hang on against Hampton. Charleston beat us up pretty good. We came back at the end and made it an 8-point game. They got it back to 11 by the end of the game, but we fought our way back. But I mean, they were up 20 a lot of the game. Charleston, I think, despite Drexel being at the top right now, I still think Charleston is probably the strongest team in the league. So we didn't play well that day. You know, Xander had 34. He went off. He went crazy for a career high. Nikita had a nice game, but Charleston was just too much for us. You hope you see them again in the tournament at some point down the road, but we won't see them again for the regular season. But they're tough. Charleston's the class of the league, and they're the reigning champs, so you have to knock them off at some point. And Drexel was the final game, and this was, to me, the most disappointing of the group, but it also was, again, you don't want to talk about moral victories all day long. You have to win games at some point, but, you know, going from last year where we couldn't buy a win anywhere, we had Drexel. They were 7-0 in the conference. I want to check that now to see if they're still at the top. But either way, at that time, they were 6-0 or 7-0 in the conference. They're still 7-0, yeah. So we go in there, and we're up 15 early. We're like, wow, like, maybe we are here. Maybe we belong here. And you knew they were going to make a run. We weren't going to win that game by double digits. We all knew it. And they make their run, and we had chances at the end of the game. What killed us was Valencia and, I believe, Cornelius Robinson getting into foul trouble and eventually fouling out of the game with over 4 or 5 minutes left. That killed us because Drexel is a physical team. And who are the most physical players on Monmouth? Probably Cornelius Boog Robinson and Jared Valencia. You can throw Jack Collins in there, maybe Nikita and a couple kids, but Boog and Valencia are very physical kids and probably our best defenders next to Jack Collins. So when you lose those two guys versus a physical team like Drexel, you're going to have problems. And, you know, we fought till the end, but that did us in the end. And you can say a couple were chippy and didn't really need to be called, but regardless, that killed us in the end. And, you know, one of the things we'll talk about later in the show is we have to find a way for Valencia to not get in foul trouble earlier in the game. It's been a trend. We've seen it in a bunch of games. And part of it is just his nature of play, blocking shots, playing above the rim, and he's going to foul sometimes. He's going to have 3 or 4 fouls most nights. That's just part of being an elite defender. And he's also young. He's a redshirt freshman. He's only, 19 years old probably? So, you know, he's going to make those mistakes sometimes. What has to be avoided is when he fouls somebody 80 feet from the basket. After a rebound, you know, he pushes or bumps the kid out of bounds or he reaches in. He's got to learn to save his fouls for when someone's attacking the basket, and because they're going to go at him. They're going to try to get him in foul trouble, and we can't afford to have him having 1 or 2 game 80 feet from the basket under the other team's hoop and him getting those fouls. We just can't afford that to happen, and there's been a lot of games. He's had 2 and 3 in the first half, and you're done. You're done for another 5 or 6 minutes before you can go back in. And, you know, that's one thing we got to kind of get figured out if we're going to stay in the court with some of these teams is Valencia's got to stay out of foul trouble. Final conference game we've seen so far, Hampton. It was a win's a win. I mean that's what it comes down to. It doesn't matter how ugly it is. And it was ugly. We did some good things in that game, but defensively, we did not get the job done versus team. We won 85-77 in the end, but guys, we were down in the final minutes. I mean, it was not looking good. They took a 4-point lead, and I'm like, this might be it. We might lose to Hampton here. And that's a game where if you win it, no matter what, you're still at least in the middle of the conference at 3-3 and possibly the top 5 or 6. You lose that game to go to 2-4 and you lose to Hampton. Well, people have no choice but to put you as a bottom third CAA team now. So thank God they get out with a win, and you know, nobody's going to care in 2 weeks that it was, you know, almost a loss, but that's a game you have to avoid losing, and luckily they pulled it out in the end. So the good news is the hardest part of our schedule is over. That three-game stretch, we knew from the preseason and we said it on the podcast it was going to be brutal, and it was. We didn't play poorly. We didn't get blown out in any game. We were there, but that part's over. Now, moving on to our next games coming up. At Stony Brook this Thursday, 6:30. It's got to be a win. Has to be a win. They're a team that's very similar to us, middle of the pack. I believe we're a little more talented. Monmouth has to start proving they can win on the road. Now, granted, most of their road games this year were versus very good teams. Okay, they haven't played anybody soft on the road yet. George Mason, very good Patriot League team. They're probably going to win it. West Virginia, Big 12 team. We got to win there. Lost at Penn. Lost at Cornell. Lost at Seton Hall. Solid team. Lost to Oklahoma. Solid team. And you lost three in a row on the road. So it's not like we're playing, you know, NEC teams on the road, like Wagner and, you know, Mount St. Mary's. We're not playing, I guess they're MAC now, but, you know, Stonehill. We're not playing those guys on the road. We're playing solid teams. So you can't look at the road record yet and say, well, they're not a good road team. Well, they haven't played anybody really in their league. I know the CAA is our league, but those teams are a half step ahead of us. And they were in every game. So you can't really say they're a bad road team yet. At Stony Brook, they have a chance this week to kind of flip that narrative and say, all right, we're fine on the road. Like, we lost some good teams, and now we're going to play some teams like us, and we're going to win a few of these. So you got to beat Stony Brook this week, and you get Hofstra, who's down right now. I believe they're 1-3 in the conference, and you are at home. Okay, so you're not going to get Hofstra lower than they are right now. They're solid every year. So this is at their low point. You need to go beat them now. If you win those two games, you're 5-3 and you're right there. Then you get Drexel coming back to you, who could be 9-0 at that point. Okay. Beating Drexel in that game puts you in the top five in the CAA. No questions asked at all. We're good. You win that game versus Drexel, you're there. Tough game versus UDel. They're not amazing. Okay. They're not a great, great team. They're a solid CAA team. It's a winnable game. Then you look at this stretch here. Home versus William & Mary. Okay. Not a great team. We can win that one. Should win that one at home. At Northeastern, we know we're a better team. Okay, they have a couple shooters. We know we're a better team than Northeastern. There's no way we should be losing that game. Then you're home versus Campbell. Average CAA team, below average. You're home versus Stony Brook in the return game. And then you're at Towson, all right? Another tough game. We already beat them once. Hopefully you play with them. And then you host North Carolina A&T. You're at Hampton. You're at Elon with Rob Higgins. Is there any game in there where you're kind of scared of anybody? Not really. We know we can play with Drexel. We play with them on the road. We can play with them at home where we play our best, right? A&T is a little better this year. Towson, solid. That'll probably be the toughest game. You look at that stretch. It softens for Monmouth. And you're going to find out very quickly who we are. If they struggle versus Delaware and Stony Brook and William & Mary, well, you're going to find out we're a lower half CAA team. If they run through a lot of those guys and they finish with an 11-7 record, well, we're a top five team then. And now we're fighting to compete for a CAA title. Now, are we a year away? I don't know. It still feels like we're a year away. It still feels like that Wilmington, Charleston, Drexel group is still a little bit ahead of us. But I don't think it's that far off. I don't think that if we get in there as a 5 seed, that we can't beat the 12 seed, take down the 4 seed in Towson, William & Mary, not William & Mary, I guess. Towson, Delaware, possibly Wilmington if they drop a little bit. We can beat one of those teams for one night. And then you go up against Drexel or Charleston as the 1 seed probably. And I don't think there's any reason we can't win versus any of these teams on one given day. I think over the course of a season, they're going to be better than us. They're a better team. But I don't think there's any reason for one night that Xander can't go off and Collins can't find his groove and Valencia isn't a complete monster for one night. Abdi doesn't hit 5 threes. All those things can happen. And we're going to get into individuals a little bit more in a minute, but this team has the pieces to make this kind of run. So if you see that schedule come up, it gets softer, and you're going to see pretty quickly when Monmouth plays the bottom to the middle of the CAA what they really are. We're going to find out really soon. So some of the things I've seen going right for Monmouth, number one, Xander Rice is Superman. I mean, that kid, we are so lucky to have him here, and I'm not just saying that because coach, but we are so fortunate that he chose Monmouth. I mean, the kid passed up $250,000, guys. Okay, he chose to come play for our team. And he's averaging 21 a game, but he's really doing better than that because he's had a few where he hasn't played great, but most nights, especially lately, he's scoring 25 to 35 every night. And, you know, King talked about it in the last post game, trying to get some guys more shots. Xander's been shooting a lot. You know, you got to get more guys more shots and keep them happy and keep them involved. And he's right. There are times where Xander takes over and we got to kind of look at everybody. But when Xander's hot, what are you supposed to do? All right, let him shoot. Let him shoot. He's probably one of the best players in the country going downhill right now. I mean, when he gets up all top of the key and he has ISO on the right side, you can't stop him. He's hitting floaters. He's going right to the basket and getting fouled. All right, he's doing reverse layups around the rim. I mean, the kid can do everything. He's so good going downhill, and he just controls the game extremely well from the point and the shooting guard positions. So we're very lucky to have Xander this year, and he's just doing everything out there. Going from son to father, I think we need to recognize for a minute that this might be the best coaching job of King's career so far. And let me explain that for a minute. You know the talent he had with Justin Robinson and Jalon Hornbeek and Micah Seaborn, and we've gone over that 100 times. He had the most talented team, one of the most in all of mid-major college basketball, okay? And the wins showed it. Obviously, they didn't get to a tournament. We all know the story. But you know they won 55 games in 2 years, and you had the talent there, okay? You had the years with Ray and Dion and those guys. You had the years with George Pappas, and then we bring in Shavar and Walker, okay? I would say that was close. I think what he's doing with this team is probably his best coaching job. Now, something we've talked about a lot over the years, timeouts. Has anybody really been complaining this year about timeouts? I feel like every game there's at least once or twice where I'm calling for a timeout at the stadium or from home watching on TV, and before I know it, I look over and I hear a whistle, and they call a timeout. It's happened almost every game. So I feel like King is doing far better in terms of managing the game and slowing things down when he needs to and calling those timeouts. We've been begging for over the years. I think he's been great with that. I think the rotations have been really solid. I think he knows when to pull guys. He knows when to kind of back off and not go after a kid and put him in the game when he shouldn't be in there. He found his core. These kids have their roles. They know their roles well, and they're playing within the roles. And that's why they're winning a lot of games right now. I know they're 10-9, but you saw their schedule. You saw who they played. All right. I don't know how we get to a much better spot than 10-9 right now. I think most of us would have signed on for 10-9 preseason, looking at what was ahead of us. And you know, I think between calling timeouts to the right spots, putting kids in the right spots, and just the way he's managing the game, I think it's the best coaching job he's done so far. And he's mixing in freshmen with transfers, with kids that were here last year. And, you know, he's not forcing things. You know, I think in the past of time, to try to make kids happy with playing time and trying to keep your kids involved, and, you know, you're not wrong to do that. But at the same time, I think things were forced at times, and it's not happening this year, all right? Now, just for an example, not throwing anybody under the bus, I'm just stating facts here. You know, Jack Holmstrom, perfect example, okay? Good kid, all right? Decent college basketball player, but he's not a super physical kid. He's not the best shooter, and he kind of played because we needed him to play last year. Now, he's not getting a lot of minutes. You know, I feel bad for him a little bit, but King's finding spots for him. All right, he's finding spots in the game where, you know, somebody on the wing needs a breather. You know, the game's not out of reach right now. Let's put Jack in. Maybe he'll hit a couple transition threes. He'll play a little defense and get him back out, because you know you need guys like Robinson and Abdi and these guys coming off the bench. You need them more than you need other guys off the bench. And, you know, the margin of error is so thin in this conference. You can't afford to have guys out there for 10, 15 minutes and they can't handle it. And I'm not saying Holmstrom can't. I'm saying there's guys that are ahead of him. And I think King has done a really good job of realizing who the core players are. And you got to stick with them for as long as you can. And then when you can find the other guys playing time, you find playing time. But I think King has ran a masterclass this year on coaching. I've never complimented him this much in the past. But I got to give credit where credit's due. He's done a really, really good job with this team. What's gone a little bit sideways? Number one, we talked about the Valencia foul trouble a little bit. It's got to change. I don't know who's in charge of big man's on the team, but, and I know part of it is he's young. Part of it is he is still pretty new to basketball. All right. He didn't play a lot in high school. King told us that. He kept transferring from state to state, trying to find somebody that would take him on with his eligibility issues. And finally, he found a spot, and he was 17 years old. All right, so we got to give him a little bit of grace. He is super athletic. He's an awesome recruit. He's probably one of the best recruits we've ever had. And we're very lucky to have him. We got to hope he stays at Monmouth for another year or two, hopefully three. But somebody, if they're not already, I'm sure they are, they got to get in his ear, and you can't reach 80 feet from the basket. You can't try to reach on a guy that's coming down with the ball. Just get back on defense and do what you do. Do not reach and cause a foul in the opening minutes of the game or any point in the game and get those cheap fouls called, because we need to save those five fouls for when somebody's attacking the basket and you're going up man-to-man on them and you're trying to block the crap out of them, and that's when we can afford a few fouls. We can't afford, you don't get eight fouls. You get five in college, okay? You get six in the NBA, you get five in college. You don't get eight, nine fouls a game, okay? They got to get Valencia to a point where he's not having those fouls so far from the basket. The other thing, you know, I'm not blaming him in any way, because we know what he's going through. Jack Collins has struggled a little bit, and he started to find it recently. You see him now kind of hitting a couple threes a game. He's starting to get back into his rhythm a little bit. You still see him missing shots that we typically didn't see him miss last year. But he's dealt with back issues. He's dealt with, I think, a toe issue. And, you know, he's going through a lot of pain. Usually his wrist is wrapped up. The guy is always bandaged up, and he's a warrior. I mean, he is the toughest kid that we've had in this program for a long time. Maybe ever, from what I've seen in the last 13 years. I don't remember a tougher kid than Jack Collins. But one thing we are going to need, if we're going to compete in the CAA in the tournament, Jack's going to have to hit shots. You know, if Xander's hitting 25, 30 and Jack's only hitting 8 or 9, we're going to have problems, because what teams are going to do is they're going to go after Abdi on defense and they're going to try to get him out of the game, because teams know now, you know, he's not the best defender. He's working on it. He's getting better, but they're going to go after Abdi. And if he's not on the court shooting the ball because he's not playing defense or he's getting beat on defense, that's one less shooter out there. All right, if they're in Valencia's face and they're not, you know, they're forcing him to shoot threes instead of letting him drive, that's one less option we have out there. And if they put a good defense together for Xander, which we've seen some teams do, it seems like we've figured that out more recently, how to get him open and how to have him not get shut down. He's scoring 25, 35 every night. But there have been some teams that have put some really, really good defenses together where Xander struggled. So we have to have somebody shooting the ball on a night where they're doubling Xander, or they're kind of spying on him and not letting him get to the basket. Jack Collins is that guy, and he's going to have to make a lot of shots. So that's one thing that definitely has to be there for this team to compete. And I believe in Jack. I have no doubt that he's going to turn the corner. He's already started to turn the corner. But for this team to win in the CAA in the end, Jack's going to have to shoot the ball really well, because at some point they're not going to let Xander do it all night. And you're going to need Valencia and Spence and Jack and Abdi and Cornelius Robinson and everybody out there. You're going to need everybody, because for 3 or 4 days in DC, they're not going to let Xander Rice run all over the court and score 30 on them. Somebody is going to figure out a way to not shut him down, because you really can't shut Xander down, but they're going to find a way to slow him down, and somebody else is going to have to step up. And once they do, and Jack hits two or three threes in a row, and Abdi hits one, Xander is going to be open again and can do his thing. That's my take on what's going to have to happen for this team to advance in the CAA. Just going over a few other guys. Like I said, Abdi's shooting the ball better than as good as anyone in the country from three. I mean, if he was getting 25, 30 minutes a game, I mean he'd be at the top of every 3-point list, because the opportunities aren't always there for him because he plays less than 20 minutes a game typically. But that kid just doesn't miss, man. You are so confident the ball's going in when that kid lets it go. And for a kid that we knew nothing about coming into the year, like, he was barely a side note on our preseason show. We didn't know if they were going to redshirt the kid. We didn't know if he was going to play. We never heard of the kid. He just signed one day, and we didn't have a lot of info on him. He's one of the best shooters in the country. So if he can keep himself on the court playing defense, he's such a weapon out there, and nobody can guard him. Nikita has been an amazing surprise for this team. We debated in the preseason what we expected from Nikita, and we knew he was going to be tough. All right, we knew, coming from Ukraine, going through the life that he's been through, his family's over there, basketball is nothing for him in terms of toughness. When you go through what he's gone through in his life and what his family's going through, you don't have to be tough to play basketball. Like, he's already tough. So he has been awesome. 9.6 points a game, 7.5 rebounds a game. He's just been outstanding for us. The consistency is getting there. It wasn't there the whole season, but I feel like consistency is getting there. He's staying out of foul trouble for the most part. His touch around the basket is getting better. I mean, he's been such a weapon for us. And if we don't get him, and if we have somebody else at center, I don't know how competitive this team is, because he does so many things for us on both sides of the ball. So Nikita's been outstanding. Valencia, we've talked about a lot. Elite defender, offense is figuring it out. I mean, we've played, what, 19 games? He's got to have at least 17 games with a putback dunk. I mean, every game he's going for a putback dunk, and it's just a lot of fun to watch. And he's just super athletic, and he's great to have on this team. We hope we can keep him. Boog Robinson, big three the other day versus Hampton, closing out that game. Probably the second or third toughest kid on the team. He's definitely in that conversation for the toughest. For a freshman, he has been awesome. And I think people don't realize just how good Boog Robinson is, because he doesn't play 20 minutes a game. But for a freshman, now he doesn't look like a freshman, okay? If you've been to a game, Boog Robinson does not look like a freshman. He looks like a fifth, sixth year senior that's seasoned a little bit. So nobody would imagine that kid's a freshman if you come into the stadium and look at him. But he is really, really tough all around the boards. You have no idea that kid's 19 years old. You'd have no clue. So, he has been a weapon for us. He can shoot the three. He can handle the ball dribbling off the court. We haven't had that many guys in the past that were his size and his position that could easily bring the ball up if he has to. Very athletic kid. I think he is going to shine for Monmouth over the next 3 to 4 years. He's going to be a huge piece to everything we're doing. So keep it up, Rogue. Spinelli's been hurt. Haven't seen him in a while. Vuga's played very sparingly with his back injury. He's definitely not himself this year. You hope he can get back for the stretch run and get himself healthy. Sandu had a big game versus Seton Hall. Sandu came out for Seton Hall, played awesome against them. We needed him with Nikita in foul trouble, and King stayed with him in the second half. Haven't seen a lot of him since, but it was a sign that Sandu has something extra in his bag of tricks, and he may be sticking around Monmouth for a while, and he may be fighting for a spot in the lineup when it's time for Nikita to eventually leave the five position and graduate. So you hope Sandu keeps developing. He's looked better this year in the sparing minutes he's played. Doyle, haven't seen him a lot lately. I think he got kind of pushed out of the rotation a little bit with Holmstrom. I think they just have their core now. They know what their core is, and they're sticking to it. You see him here and there for defense purposes, but we know who is out there now. It was good to see Sam Fagan finally on the court. He got a few minutes in a few different games so far, and I got to tell you, I don't hate his game. He's looked pretty solid when he's out there. I know it's mostly garbage time, but he looks pretty solid running the point out there. He's not a big kid. He is small. He is small, but he runs a nice point, and I got to tell you, I'm excited to see what he can do in the future, and hopefully he can stick around. I don't think he'll be a starter for us necessarily, but I could see him being a decent a role backup point guard for us and doing a decent job there. You need depth in the CAA, so I'm excited to see what Fagan can do in the future. Like I just kind of finish up here, there's no reason, guys, that this team can't finish top five in the CAA. The next couple of weeks, we're going to find out. All right, when they're going up against William & Mary, Northeastern, Delaware, Stony Brook, Campbell, A&T, you're going to find out who this Monmouth team really is. And I have a good idea of who they are. I think there's a good chance we get to 11-7 in the conference, which would be a massive improvement. And any of us would have signed up for that in the preseason. The games that I worry about, obviously Drexel there at the top. At Delaware is a little bit challenging. At Towson, other than that, I'm not worried about anybody. You're probably going to drop one somewhere that you're not expecting. But I don't see any huge worries on that schedule. My guess is they finish at least 10-8. Hopefully they get to 11-7 or somewhere in that range. They're going to lose a couple here and there, but I really believe this team has a chance to make a run this year. And are they a tournament team? I don't know. They're young. They're talented. They're tough. Can they beat Charleston, Wilmington, Drexel, Towson when it comes to March in D.C.? We're going to find out, but I don't see there's a reason why they can't. You saw what the women's team did last year, right? Again, different sport, but sixth seed. They took down some really, really talented CAA women's teams, okay? I don't see a reason why on one weekend, one long week in D.C., why we can't come up with three or four wins. So I think we're going to be there. I think we're going to be there in the end. We're going to be right with these guys, so we'll see what happens. Before I finish up here, please note, there's something on Twitter regarding the playlist for Saturday's game. I believe you can tweet at the basketball account. There's a certain link, I believe, where you can suggest songs for the DJ to play on Saturday. Good idea for Monmouth there. And also, they are hosting the Beer Garden, hosting that 1933 Great Hall IPA at Saturday's game. Starts at 12:30. The Beer Garden opens. It'll be behind the student section on the concourse when you first walk up the main steps there. Anyone 21 or older is able to join. It'll go through halftime, I believe. It'll stop around halftime. So you have 12:30 to probably 2:30 to try those 1933s and let me know how they are. All right. I won't be there Saturday. I'll explain in a minute. But let me know how they are and how the Beer Fest goes. Sounds like an awesome event. Trying to bring some more students and fans in. And it's good on Monmouth to try some new marketing things like this. Some good marketing stuff. I said on Twitter the other day, my time for home games is likely over for this year. My wife, Nicole, is due with our first child in about 9 or 10 days. So trying to keep COVID and RSV and flu and anything else off of me for that time is more important. I'm missing the games. I was disappointed I couldn't go this week, and I'm gonna miss them coming up. But they are testing in the hospital for COVID, and I can't risk not being in the delivery room for her. And because I went to a basketball game, it just doesn't add up. It wasn't worth it. So I'll be watching from home for sure. I'll be tweeting out, following every play. But after that, we have one, two, three, four or five home games, and I'm gonna have a newborn. So it's gonna be very hard to sneak out to West Long Branch with a baby at home. But I'll be following closely. I'll be watching. I'll be tweeting, and my goal is to do another podcast, hopefully next week, so we can rile off a few of these before the season's over and keep you guys in the loop. But regardless, thank you guys for all the support. We're very excited to welcome the newest Monmouth fan to the club. We don't know boy or girl yet, so we'll see what happens. Yeah, we're very excited. I got a lot of well wishes on Twitter last week, and I appreciate everybody. And I appreciate everybody's listening anyway. I had a guy, I have no idea who he was, but I had a guy come up to me leaving the Monmouth game versus, I guess it was Northeastern. He just came out to me and goes, "Are you the podcast guy?" And I said, "Yeah." And he goes, "You guys do fantastic work. Keep it up. We really appreciate you guys doing what you do." And that means a lot. I've been doing this for 4 or 5 years now, and it means a lot when people come up to you. You have no idea who they are, and they tell you you're doing a good job, and they thank you for what you're doing. And it's appreciated. We don't get paid for this. We do it because we love the team, and we love the sports banter. And it's an outlet for the fans to kind of just talk with us and talk with each other. So thank you to everybody for all the support. We'll let you know as soon as baby's born and the newest Monmouth fan. And I'll talk to you guys on Facebook and Twitter, and I'll keep you guys in the loop. But for now, at Stony Brook 6:30 on Thursday night, and then we host Hofstra, a big game this Saturday, 2 o'clock at the OceanFirst Bank Center in West Long Branch. And make sure you get to that beer fest with the 1933 Great Hall IPAs starting 12:30 at the student section. All right. Thank you guys for everything. Thank you for listening. Spread the word. We're on here. Have a great night.